In the previous two videos, we talked about the concepts of uniform circular motion, where we discussed the ideas about angular displacement, angular velocity, and we also talked about centripetal acceleration, the acceleration that keeps an object within the circular motion. If that acceleration is withdrawn, the object cannot stay in the circular motion anymore. Now, in this topic of non-uniform circular motion, we'll talk about those situations when the object is not going around at a constant speed. So let's start off by understanding what is the meaning of non-uniform circular motion. So when a particle travels along a circular path at changing speed or variable speed, the motion is referred to as non-uniform circular motion. This is in complete contrast with what we learned as a uniform circular motion. Both magnitude and direction of velocity keeps changing. So in our uniform circular motion, only the direction changed, the magnitude of velocity remained constant. But in non-uniform circular motion, the magnitude may also change, which means the object may speed up or slow down. Now, to get a better understanding of non-uniform circular motion, we'll be discussing the topics of tangential acceleration and angular acceleration. First of all, talking about tangential acceleration, this acceleration acts along the tangent of the circle. Now, as you already know, the velocity or the linear velocity in case of a circular motion is tangential. So if this acceleration also acts tangentially, either it will end up being parallel or anti-parallel to my velocity. So in that situation, this acceleration will directly affect the magnitude of the instantaneous velocity, or in our case, the speed which was constant in case of uniform circular motion. To understand it better, imagine the circular motion to be a linear motion by cutting the circle open into a line. Now, if the object is traveling towards the left side, and my acceleration is also acting towards the left side, in that case the magnitude of velocity will keep on increasing. And if my object is traveling to left and the acceleration is acting rightwards, the magnitude of velocity will keep on decreasing. Now take that line and create the circle back from that line and do not change anything. So in that situation, what you will see is that the velocity has clearly become tangential once again. And if tangential acceleration is parallel to velocity, it will increase the instantaneous speed or magnitude of instantaneous velocity of the object. If it acts opposite, tangentially, but opposite to the velocity, it will decrease the magnitude of instantaneous velocity. That is the job of AT, or the tangential acceleration. Now, AT vector can be expressed as dV vector by dt, where V vector is the instantaneous velocity vector. Now, because AT vector is either parallel or anti-parallel to velocity vector, the same relationship can also be written in terms of their magnitude. So I can say magnitude of tangential acceleration, which is AT, is equal to dV by dt, where V is the magnitude of instantaneous velocity. So as you can see, this relationship will hold for their magnitudes also. Please have a good look at these two equations, as they'll be very, very important for the problem solving in case of non-uniform circular motion. Now let's talk about the concept of angular acceleration. The symbol we use to represent angular acceleration is alpha. Now, angular acceleration is defined as the rate of change of angular velocity with respect to time, and it is also a vector quantity. Now, alpha vector can be written as d omega vector by dt, or the rate of change of angular velocity with respect to time. Now you can see that in our circular motion kinematics, we had angular displacement theta, we had angular velocity omega. So it was only obvious for us to introduce the angular acceleration alpha in the series. Now we have the entire kinematics complete for circular motion. Now the direction of angular acceleration can either be parallel to angular velocity or anti-parallel to angular velocity. If it's parallel, the magnitude of angular velocity will keep on increasing. If it's anti-parallel, it will keep on decreasing. So on practical terms, if angular velocity is clockwise and angular acceleration is anti-clockwise, in that situation, angular velocity will decrease. It will be a case of retardation. And if angular velocity is clockwise and angular acceleration is also clockwise, in that situation, the angular velocity's magnitude will increase and it will be the case of acceleration. Also, you can imagine that if an object stops to undergo a constant uniform circular motion and starts to speed up or slow down within its circular motion, clearly the rate of change of angular velocity will also change, because if the object speeds up, it will cover more angle per unit time, and if the object slows down, it will cover less angle per unit time. So you can already intuitively see that there must be some connection between alpha and AT, which is our tangential acceleration. That relationship we'll explore in the next section. Now let's try and explore the relationship between tangential acceleration and angular acceleration. So it will all start with the fundamental relationship between tangential velocity and angular velocity, which we studied in the last video, which was v is equal to omega r, where v is the tangential velocity and omega is the angular velocity. These are their magnitudes, of course. In vector form, we already have seen it is v vector is equal to omega vector cross r vector. So taking their magnitudes only for now, if we differentiate both sides with respect to time, then on the left side, we'll obtain dv by dt. And from the first slide, we already saw dv by dt is nothing but tangential acceleration at. So we'll put it as at. And on the right hand side, it will come out to be d omega r by dt. Now, when an object is undergoing circular motion, the radius of the circle will not vary, will not change. So r clearly is a constant with respect to time. So r can simply come out of the derivative. So what we are left with is r multiplied by d omega by dt. Now, in the last section, we saw that d omega by dt is nothing but angular acceleration. So this can be replaced by alpha. So the relationship we obtain is tangential acceleration is equal to r into alpha. This is very, very similar to the first equation of v is equal to r omega. This can be written as at is equal to r alpha. Direct derivative from this equation, we can obtain the relationship between tangential acceleration and angular acceleration. Now let's talk about the vector forms of these relationships that we have just obtained. So in the previous video, we already discussed about this, that tangential velocity vector v is equal to omega vector cross r vector, where omega vector is the angular velocity. In the same fashion, the relationship between accelerations that we have derived, we know that tangential acceleration at vector is nothing but alpha vector cross r vector, where alpha vector is the angular acceleration. Now, these two relationships are very important for you and you should remember them. Now, the angle between velocity vector and r vector is always 90 degrees. Why? Because velocity vector acts tangentially and tangent is always perpendicular to radius in case of by the basic geometry of a circle. Similarly, the angle between at vector and r vector is also 90 degrees because tangential acceleration is also tangential, which means it will be perpendicular because it acts along the tangent to the radius. So I hope these basic ideas about the non-uniform circular motion are clear to you. We'll be solving a couple of problems in the problem section. So please keep an eye out and I hope you like the video. Thank you.